Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
And dear Heavenly Father, help us tonight as we go through this meeting to do what's best for the county and keep the citizens of this county in mind as we do that. These things we ask in thy name. Amen.
Amen.
Let's stand in place.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Eddie.
Yes, sir.
This time we'll call the meeting of the Alamance Board of Commissioners together for first meeting in August. Welcome to everyone. Thank you for being here and enjoying the cool air that we're having inside anyway. The first item is the approval of the agenda, which would include the consent agenda. Commissioners, if you will take just a minute and review the agenda that you have in front of you. I have had one request for item number 9, which has to do with the urgent repair program assistance policy. That is going to be presented by Jason Martin, but with the technical support from the same individual, I believe, from the where's Jason?
He's right.
From the architectural firm, is that right?
From the contractors.
To follow the public hearing about the community block development grant. So if commissioners have no objection, I'd like to move item number 9 up right after the public hearing, which would make it the new item number 7, and then the other two would just fall down after that. Any objection to that one?
None.
Okay. Commissioners, any other items that you see that we need to discuss on the regular or consent agenda?
I would like to pull B out, the agreement with Coble Landfill. Had some questions on that, and if we could pull it out to discuss that.
Okay, can we talk about that following item number 10, Eddie?
That would be fine.
Okay, so the franchise agreement will be our new item 11 in the regular agenda. Any others? Hearing none, I will entertain a motion to accept the agenda, which would include the remaining items on the consent agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Bill, is there a second? Eddie, thank you. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Very good. That's the approval of the agenda, including the consent agenda. Next item are public comments. I have three. I'd like to begin inviting Henry Vines up to talk about the ACC bond. Mr. Vines, welcome.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. I hope y'all are doing good this afternoon. First of all, before I speak on the ACC bond, I would like to ask for something on the consent agenda. Could we move that to after the public comment so that if when the public has something that they're concerned about on the consent agenda, that they can make their comments or whatever, you know, about something that's in the consent agenda before it's approved? And I'd appreciate y'all's consideration on that. I mean, you know, if there's an item in there that maybe some of the citizens have concerns about, that they could pull it out and ask y'all to discuss it. The other is the ACC bond. I read through the resolution, and I was trying to get some understanding. I wanted to be sure that I was reading and understanding this correctly, that the bond issue is going to be put on the ballot now, and if I'm reading that correctly, and doing so, if that bond is approved, according to what I'm reading in the resolution, and the quarter cent sales tax is not approved, then it will not be built. My question is, I mean, if the people vote for that to go through, can you deny not, you know, giving that bond and building that facility? because, I mean, the resolution states that if the quarter cent sales tax don't go through, that property taxes will not be raised to pay for that. So my question is, you know, can you do that? Do you have the authority to do that as commissioners, going against what the vote says on a bond that's on the ballot? And also, the second thing I would like to ask is, y'all discussed about where this money is going to go from the sales tax standpoint. I would like for you to look at and consider lowering the amount of years that we're going to pay on this bond if we build this facility from 15 to 5. You know, $3.8 million would make it and would, you know, get rid of that bond in 5 years. With the talk of a new high school being maybe possibly being needed in the near future, and that's going to be a large debt to the county, I think that we would be better served if we could retire as much as our debt as soon as we can, because, I mean, I think the new school, help me, Tom, is about $45 million, is that correct, or more?
$60 million.
You know, so we're looking, you know, at $60 million worth of debt. You know, we're running $82 million now without this 15 added to it. So I would, as a citizen, appreciate that y'all would look at this and discuss this. And, I mean, I know the economic development is important, too, but, you know, our debt is important, too, and I think we can pay this off in 5 years instead of 15.
Thank you
for your time.
Mm-hmm. Next to provide public comment is Hugh Webster, our current Register of Deeds. And Mr. Webster, I could not read what your subject matter was.
That was not an accident. Subject matter is, and I hope I won't have to address y'all with this, but I would seriously hope that our county commissioners would not engage in this emergency ordinance. But when I look back through history, it would only make Adolf Hitler happy. When I read about it, and I'm talking about the emergency ordinance that would prevent us from having gasoline or guns or going to work or opening our businesses. And I feel like I just shouldn't have to talk with y'all about it. You should know. Don't do that. But if you do it, I'll be talking to a different set of county commissioners next time. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Webster. Our final speaker is Mr. Eddie Shue. I can read what his subject matter is, but I would prefer not to repeat it.
I didn't know what it was myself.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners. I want to speak real fast about, I say, travel. Maybe things have changed. I thought that before tonight, if I read the agenda packet right, you got one approved that the training can be done in-state, but instead of going out-of-state and say they'll come back and train, they could do the same with, you know, when it's in-state. Now, I'm not sure. I think that's why I read in the agenda packet. I don't have the packet in front of me. Last week, you approved one that says it's required training, and I haven't found anybody that says it's required training. I asked Chief Deputy Britt a while ago, and he said he didn't think it was required for nothing he knows about. So it's check required training, but required for what? On that particular one of the instructors was convicted in federal court of denying due process and civil rights violations against El Paso police officers. Now that's a fact. I mean, you can look it up. So when y'all, you know, the idea to put this, all this agenda stuff ahead of what the people said, we might, you know, we're not the brightest bulbs in the pack, but we might just save you some trouble sometime. On the, I kind of agree with you on that deal with the gas, I mean, that's what it say, 5-10 gallons of gas, how long is it going to run the generator tires out after the storm comes through? I mean, this thing ain't been thought through. And if I want to make a bomb, I know things better than gas. So if that was their thinking, the governor, the way I understand it, always understood it, can declare a state of emergency. If it gets bad enough, they can actually declare a martial law in this country. So why do we need these local yokels running around telling us what we can have in a house and what we can't? It's just, they just want power. I mean, they want to feel important. Give them a cereal box badge and let them all run around town. I don't care. And on this thing with ACC, because, see, those people that you're talking about, they had the passes. You throw the ID up, then you go through the line. You're an EMT or somebody else. See? So what are they going to keep us home for? And look to our house. On the ACC bond, the only thing I can say about that, I don't know the right or wrong of it, but I was totally, when they stood up here the first time, shaking their heads to the thought of a sales tax, like, I was affronted. It bothered me. That was kind of arrogant. We don't want to put it to the voters. We want y'all to do it. So I didn't think much of that either. So you can see, that's about all I got to say.
Thank you, Eddie. This time, one of two times for commissioners' responses. Do we have any responses at this time?
Chairman, I would like to respond to his out-of-state travel thing, and here it is, Mr. Shue, and there was no cost to the county on that, is why that was put into the agenda. We did agree to put things at cost.
No travel cost, did
not? Not to the county, no, sir.
Okay.
It's done through Homeland Security.
Thank you. Any other comments at this time? If not, we'll move to item number 6, the public hearing for the 2010 Community Block Development Grant, the budget amendment, and ask Jason Martin. Welcome, sir.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, good evening. You should have in your packet a brief memorandum from me regarding the 2010 Scattered Sites CDBG project. As you know, the county was awarded a grant for $400,000 in 2010. Under the Community Development Block Grant Program to do housing repairs for low to moderate income citizens in the county. The budget amendment that you have in front of you is a requirement from the state of North Carolina Department of Commerce in order for the county to receive reimbursement under the grant. With that, I'll take any questions you have at this time. And also, I would like to point out that we have Michael Walser here this evening, who is our grant administrator on these projects, and he can provide technical answers to questions you may have as well.
The agenda calls for a public hearing. Do we need to have a motion at this time to go into the public hearing, or are you asking for questions prior to that?
If there are no questions, then we can just go into the public hearing.
Okay.
Where were most of the houses that this hit? Was this the Belmont?
They were scattered throughout the community.
Scattered.
Yeah.
I know Belmont got some at one point. And,
I know there was one in some in Gibsonville and Elon.
Okay.
Basically, with this particular grant, we can do things anywhere in the county except the city of Burlington. Can't do anything within the city limits there.
Okay.
Jason, on the administration there of $40,000, who gets that?
That is the grant administrator.
The grant people,
That's their contracted amount.
Okay.
Other questions? If not, we'll entertain a motion to go into a public hearing for the purpose of input from the public on the Community Block Development Grant 2010. Is there such a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. Bill, Linda, any discussion about the motion to go into the public hearing? Hearing none, any objections? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Public hearing is now open. Would you like to conduct the public hearing for us?
I have nothing more to add.
Are there individuals that would like to speak on the 2010 Community Block Development Grant?
Of course.
Yes, sir.
This is no cost to all of the county.
Right. This is federal grant, isn't it?
That is correct.
Yes. Federal grant. I imagine much use for this.
Henry?
I just have one request. I was reading through the, you know, the plan and all, and there's a list there, Jason listed, of who's going to be notified, all the different organizations. I'd like to know as to why the area of community churches are not being notified on that list. I think maybe that they should be added to that list, the community churches.
Henry, I think that's the urgent repair programs, which you're
saying. Okay.
Yeah, that's the
okay.
Yeah.
Is that on the public hearing?
No.
No, it's not on the public hearing, but it's the next agenda.
Well, how about adding that on there?
Thank you, Henry. Any other comments? Thank you. We'll entertain a motion that the public hearing be closed.
So moved.
Thank you, Eddie. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, Jason. We will now move to, after the public hearing then, is there anything, Jason, that the board needs to do to actually approve your report now that the public hearing is over?
No, sir. That's what I was just checking to make sure.
Okay.
That's it.
That's good.
Very good. Now we're going to have item 9, which is also going to be led by Jason, the 2012 Urgent Repair Program Assistance Policy and Procurement Policy.
Yes, this, again, you should have a memorandum in your packet from me. This is the 2012 Urgent Repair Program. It's a $75,000 grant that we received through the North Carolina Housing Finance Agency. This is to do urgent repairs for low to moderate income citizens in the county. Again, this particular program is for those types of repairs, such as heating and cooling, roofing, floors, things that are urgent in nature. As part of the program, the county has to adopt an assistance policy, a procurement policy, and a program budget, and all three of those should be in your packet this evening. I'd like to address Mr. Vines's question, if I may, at this time.
Sure. Okay. Absolutely.
Just for my own clarification, the notification that is for to get folks that may need assistance from. One of the suggestions that I was speaking with our grant administrator about is to possibly use allied churches who kind of coordinate with all the churches in the community. That way it's, as opposed to soliciting directly to every church, something like that, to where it can be just a clearinghouse. And I think that's something that we could do. So I think it's a great idea. But with that, I'll be glad to take any other questions you all have at this time. And I don't know if Mr. Walter has anything he would like to add.
What's the vetting process for these people when they come to get this done? I mean,
for the assistance?
Yeah, explain that a little
okay.
bit.
Okay. Actually, I think, Michael, if you don't mind, you're would be the better one to explain that.
I'm sorry. And what's the question again?
When the folks that are in need, what is the procedure that they need to follow to, you know, get this, and who decides, yes, you okay. qualify, okay. you don't qualify?
What we'll do is following the approval of these policies tonight, because the good thing about this program is the policies are forwarded to the state, to the agency. They've reviewed these. They've already said, commissioners, adopt these as presented. You can move forward with your program. So what following tonight, if these are approved, first thing will happen is a notice will be made in the paper. We'll also get notice out to the churches as well as to civic organizations, the local units of government within the county, any agency that works with the elderly and disabled folks, any means possible to try to get this notice out. And what this does, it says if you need an application, you'd like to make application, you come to our office, you come to the county's planning department to get that application. We have people that's on our waiting list. The county's been working in programs like this forever. We'll notify all those people and let them know this funding's out there and it's available, and that they need to reapply if their application is more than 6 months old. We usually leave about a two-week window following the notice of the advertisement. So once we get all those applications in, the assistance policy has a rating and ranking schedule in there that rates
so
and ranks the applications.
They
have to be low or very low income. The very low income is going to rate higher, but then if low income will also rate. They also have to have a special need, be elderly, disabled, homeowner, elderly disabled occupant, single parent household, or large family. Your elderly and disabled homeowners, they're going to rate the highest.
Okay.
And then it comes down from there. And so all the applications pretty much rate rank themselves. Now, what happens is there could be a situation where there's a tie. They get the same score. Right. And the way we handle that is it says it's a first-come, first-served basis. So whoever got their application in first, if there's a tie, that's how we sort those out. So.
And the amount, I think it's, what, a 6,000 cap on that?
Yeah, no more than 6,000, yeah. Right. So basically we can treat one item. So, you know, roof, the heating system, handicap sales building, but one item.
So I think the preliminary intake form that's submitted to us that we forward to them, then at that point, income verification is done to make sure that they meet the requirements.
Okay. On page 2, it makes reference to cannot be located inside the city limits of the city of Burlington. Is that just Burlington or all municipalities?
No, just Burlington.
What's the reasoning for that?
They're an entitlement community, so they get financial assistance directly from HUD every year, whereas you guys have to compete for your funds. This was a competitive cycle. We've only gotten these funds about twice over the past 15 years, so it's very competitive.
This is the third time we've got this one.
So they can get funds, too.
And what about the other municipalities?
All the municipalities are qualified except Burlington. They're the only entitlement community.
What about ETJ? The ETJ's up.
Not a problem. Just the city limits.
Okay. So then the ETJ that could apply.
They could, yes.
Any other questions? Do we need a motion to accept this grant then for $75,000? Is that the aggregate amount?
Right, and to approve the policy, the assistance policy, procurement policy, and project budget.
Which is with our material here.
Right.
Is there such a motion?
I'll make that motion.
I'll second it.
Thank you, Eddie. Linda, any other discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
Mr. Chair, you need to vote on item 6. I don't believe you voted on that budget amendment.
No, we didn't.
I was asking Jason.
We didn't have to have it adopted for the state. It was just that the state required to hold the public hearing.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Should we, just to be safe, Mr. Attorney?
I'm fine with that.
Well, I think it'd be recommended to vote on it.
Can we revisit this?
Community block grant.
Yes.
Right.
What we're looking for is a motion to approve the budget amendment as was presented by Jason and after the public hearing. Is there such a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Eddie, any other discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
No.
Thank you. Thanks, Jason.
Thank you.
Okay, the next item on the agenda is the discussion of the funding mechanisms for the ACC bond indebtedness. And I asked Craig if I could just kind of lead us through this a little bit based on what we found out after our initial discussion and approval of the sales tax issued our last meeting. And commissioners, you have in your package actually three different documents. There's actually four, but two of them are together that I just kind of want to update everyone on. The first one is the resolution that we passed last time, basically to take to the voters a quarter-cent sales tax referendum for the November ballot. By law, according to our county attorney, we cannot say anything more than what you see on the resolution for the sales tax, and I'll just read that. It's either for or against local sales and use tax at the rate of 0.25% in addition to all other state and local sales and use taxes. We put that to a motion. It was unanimous, and that is where that is. At the time, it was the county staff's understanding that based on having this, we would not have to have a separate referendum to actually authorize the issuance of the bonds. And after further review, what we learned was there's a threshold amount of $12 million above which you do need to take to the voters the right of passage of voting on whether or not to accept and be in favor of issuing bonds. In this case, $15 million for the purpose of the construction of the Applied Technology Center at the campus at Alamance Community College. We really have three choices at this point. One is to go ahead and thanks to the work of staff, go ahead and address this tonight with the understanding is that we do have time to get it placed on the ballot as a separate issue that would be for the $15 million for the issuance of bonds. That was one choice. The second choice is to wait and have a separate referendum, perhaps in the spring, which was problematic in two respects. It would obviously take more time, and thus limit the or delay further the actual construction of the building. And also, with a countywide election in the spring, during perhaps the only other time, maybe some municipal elections, it would cost a lot just to have a single issue on the county ballot. And we actually had that discussion when we talked about this a year or so ago. And then the third option was to try to break the bond issue down into two components that would each be less than $12 million. And really, if you look at the project, it is one project, it is $15 million. It didn't seem prudent to proceed that way. So where we are tonight, if we can just go through the papers a little bit here, following the sales tax resolution, which we did pass last time, the second proposed resolution is the single sheet that you have right under that. And I'm just going to read that. It's not long, but this is how it would be on the ballot. And after talking with Clyde Albright, and actually was on conference call with the bond council about this, because all of us were concerned about the use or the contingencies on being able to pass the bonds using the sales tax proceeds. So everybody should have that. It says proposed resolution at the top. I see Linda's wooden chair. Okay. This is how it would appear on the ballot. In addition to the sales tax issue, and it's a for or against, shall the order adopted on August 20th, 2012, we'll talk about that date in just a minute, authorizing not exceeding $15 million community college bonds of the County of Alamance, North Carolina, for the purpose of providing funds with any other available funds for expanding and improving the facilities for Alamance Community College, including the construction of an additional building and other facilities to provide additional space for classrooms, laboratories, and storage, and the acquisition of any necessary land, equipment, furnishings, and authorizing the levy of taxes in amounts sufficient to pay the principal of and the interest on said bonds be approved. That was a question. And it's either for or against. Now, that's the wording that has to go on the ballot. So in order to accompany that wording, there are actually two documents right behind that would call to the order of processing that request. And again, I appreciate what Clyde Albright has done on this, because if we approve this tonight, the resolution I just read is one that would appear on the ballot after these orders are taking place. And the orders basically amount to a couple of resolutions that we would say. The first one relating to the authorization of the community college bonds, and the second one would be, I believe, the dollar amount, order authorizing $15 million community college bonds. So that's kind of part two, but we can't do part two without discussing part three, which is the third document in this section. And I would like to take a moment and read this. This again was prepared by our county attorney, county manager. And here, what this says is that, for instance, if the sales tax issue was not approved, but the bonds were, that the county commission is not obligated to issue the bonds. The law allows the passage of the bond issue without a return to the voters for up to 7 years. So in essence, we could sit on the request if it's not funded by a sales tax, and have the authority to do that. The reason for that is because in some situations, a bond would pass and then the entity would go out and find the land and do the drawings, and it could be a period of years before the project would actually start. So that's the intent behind why that's in place. Specifically, the resolution, I'm not going to read all the whereases that Clyde put on, but I'm going to read most of them. Resolution of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners. This is not a ballot item. This is our resolution. If the voters of the county approve an order authorizing $15 million general obligation community college bonds at a referendum, then such bonds will not be issued until a funding source other than an increase in real property tax is expected to be available to pay for such bonds. And further resolving, and then the rest of the resolution has to do with what we said the use of the sales tax would be for if it passed. And specifically, the wording that Clyde has put in here, I'm halfway down the first page, whereas North Carolina General Statute 159-54 does not allow such order to have any conditions or contingencies. In other words, the resolution, as it would be on the ballot, was not restrictive. And whereas the Alamance County Board of Commissioners wishes to commit and confirm that if such order is approved by the voters, then the bonds will not be issued until a funding source other than an increase in real property taxes is expected to be available. Then the second part of that document, basically, whereas the Alamance County Board of Commissioners recognizes the need for new facilities to house training and education programs designed to prepare the local workforce for future job opportunities, and whereas the Alamance County Board of Commissioners further recognizes the need for providing funds for economic development purposes with an emphasis in Alamance County for infrastructure extensions and industrial land development, and whereas the levy of Article 46, 1/4 cent sales and use tax would provide an incremental source of revenue to Alamance County in the amount of approximately $3.8 million annually, now be it therefore resolved by the Alamance County Board of Commissioners the following. Number one, the Board of Commissioners hereby resolves to apply proceeds from Article 46, which is the sales tax, to letter A, debt service for the construction of the Alamance Community College Applied Technology Center through the issuance of $15 million in bonds, B, economic development expenditures through establishing a fund of up to $5 million to support activities within Alamance County relating to economic development opportunities, including but not limited to potential land purchases and infrastructure extensions. The last paragraph, be it further resolved that should the issue of the levy of Article 46, 1/4 cent county sales and use tax be defeated in the November 6, 2012 general election, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners is under no obligation to proceed with the process of issuing bonds in the amount of $15 million for the purpose of construction of the Alamance Community College Applied Technology Center. So what would happen if this order is followed is we would have two ballot items, which we acknowledge can be and will be perhaps a little confusing to voters. But the first ballot item will be for the sales tax. The second item will be for the issuance of bonds for the Applied Technology Center in the amount of $15 million. If they both pass, then the school will proceed. We'll proceed with issuing funds for the school, be paid back by the sales tax revenue. If the sales tax issue fails, then the bond issue will not proceed. And I guess it's conceivable that the sales tax could pass and the bond issue could fail, at which time we would have an additional revenue source coming into Alamance County revenue. And that would be dealt with in future budget cycles. But that's kind of the story. And Clyde, is that pretty much the flow?
Yes, it is.
Do you have anything to add?
We took great pains to make sure that all of this complied with the rules and regulations, not only of North Carolina, but of our bond council in New York, because these bonds have to be marketable, and the market demands certainty, and so that's why we had to go through these steps. We can't have a contingency on the revenue bonds.
And I mentioned the August 20th date. That's 2 weeks from tonight. If we go through this process and pass these orders of resolution, then a public hearing is actually set for us to formally approve this 2 weeks from tonight, which is the August 20th date. Now, we're really pushing the ballot, because obviously the elections board is interested in printing out the ballots. However, because the presumed Republican presidential candidate has not named the vice president, the ballots can't be printed anyway. So we feel like we do have some time, and Kathy Holland will work with us to make sure that's not a time constraint, from my understanding. So it's tight, but we can get everything done we need to get this on the ballot to make it work. So before we move on for the motions to go through the resolutions, let's open it up for any questions of Clyde or Craig, because I've told you everything I know.
Do we have to have a public hearing on this?
That's what would be 2 weeks from tonight.
Okay.
Right. So tonight.
You just said August 20th. Okay, that's what I thought we could have a public hearing.
That's correct. That's what the August 20th date would be for.
Okay.
So basically, tonight, we're going to set a public hearing for the 20th, or?
Yes, if.
Yes.
There's two orders that we need to, actually resolutions that we need to pass. One has to do with the resolution relating to the authorization of the bonds, and the second one has to do with the amount of those bonds being $15 million.
And that's the bond order?
The bond order, yes.
And then we will publish that bond order in the newspaper.
And that sets the stage for the public hearing, which again, we can meet all the deadlines for, to have 2 weeks tonight, 2 weeks from tonight.
And we are right up against the deadline, the statutory deadline.
But the important thing I want everybody to understand is we have built in as much contingency wording here as we possibly legally can, and with our resolution, it gives us the flexibility for not issuing the bonds if the sales tax does not pass.
So there's no legal ramification if the bond passes and we just decide not to fund it, right? Is that what?
Well, the term is not to issue the bonds. You have 7 years to issue the bonds.
Okay.
And we probably ought to say something about the vote is actually an advisory vote. Is that correct?
This is a bond referendum. This vote, you're actually asking the voters, yes or no, do you want us to authorize $15 million in general obligation bonds? The other was an advisory referendum.
The sales tax is the advisory. Okay. Any other questions about that before we introduce the resolutions? There are two, and I'll read the resolution and then ask for a motion. The first one is...
May I ask one sure. question? How binding are these resolutions from one board to the next?
Well, and that's a good question, because they do hobble the... they put a cloud on this bond. And there's a question about marketability, and the bond council and I talked about that. So if this board 4 years from now is no longer the board, then another board's going to have to contend with this resolution.
Do we really have any other alternative?
Well, with the market in the state that it's in now, with municipalities and counties filing for bankruptcy, I don't think we have any other alternative if we're going to issue bonds.
Any other questions, comments? Let me read, and again, these two resolutions would get us to where Clyde can go ahead and prepare the documents for the order for the public hearing to be scheduled on August 20th. And the first one is the resolution simply relating to the authorization of community college bonds of the County of Alamance, North Carolina. Is there a motion to approve that resolution?
So moved.
Second. Bill, Eddie, any other discussion about that resolution? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. And then the second one specifically identifies the order authorizing $15 million community college bonds. Is there a motion to approve the order authorizing $15 million in community college bonds?
So moved.
Thank you, Linda. Is there a second?
Second.
Eddie, any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, thank you. With that, with those motions, then the public hearing will be formulated and directed to be here on August 20th, beginning at our 7 o'clock meeting, at which time, if it's passed, the items, as I read, will both appear on the ballot in November.
Now, do you want the third resolution? Yeah.
Need to vote on that one too?
Yes.
Okay, the third resolution is the one that is not for the ballot item, but the resolution that I read basically saying that if the sales tax does not pass, this board is not obligated to fund the $15 million in bonds, which was the contingency we discussed last time. Is there a motion to approve that resolution?
So moved.
Bill, is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Tim. Any other discussion about that? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. And thank you guys, Flag, Greg, for moving that thing along.
Yes, sir.
Again, the two items will appear on the ballot. They'll be next to each other, but they will not be related to each other. Next item is the order of collection, charge off of 2002 property taxes and annual settlement. Gerald, welcome, sir.
Thank you. Good evening. It's a pleasure and a blessing to be here as usual. My first order of business is to receive the order of tax collections from the chairman of the commissioners. This order authorizes me to collect all taxes owed to the county and empowers me to use any legal methods to collect those taxes. Secondly, the charge off of 2002 property taxes, North Carolina General Statute 105-378A establishes a 10-year statute of limitation for the collection of taxes. That 10 years for 2002 will be up September the 1st of this year. So we need to charge that off. The total amount of the charge off is $97,885.07. We have used every means at our disposal to collect that money. We've collected about 99.9% of the 2002 taxes. The real property, we've collected all but $38,908. Motor vehicles, $58,976. Now, motor vehicles only represents about 10% of the total levy, but it's much tougher to collect the motor vehicles than it is the real property. We've done everything we can do. We've levied on about 250 cars. We've turned people into ICC Datamax, which is a collection service. We've done all that we legally can to collect this money, and there's just no way we're going to collect any more this year.
Unless you go down to Mexico and confiscate some cars, right?
Oh, it'd be a lot of gas to get down there, I guess.
Gerald, how's the dollar figure of $97,000? How does that compare? You said the percentage, but like, do you remember 12 months ago what you charged off for 2001, for instance?
No, sir, I don't have.
I'm curious.
Last year.
Oh, you? We haven't.
Last year we charged off $83,000 for 2001, $83,774 for 2001. Actually, what's owing on 2003 is quite a bit less than 2002. I don't know why 2002 stands out, but we have a larger balance there than we do some of the other years.
Okay. Has the towing cars in helped some?
That's worked very well. We've collected about $125,000 through vehicle levies. And Sheriff's Department has done a great job helping us with that, and commend them for that.
Thank you.
Other questions for Gerald on this item? You need a motion for approval of the order of tax collection. Is that correct, Gerald?
Yes, sir.
That's the first item that Gerald covered. Is there a motion to approve the order of tax collection, which would allow Gerald to continue to do his job?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? And then the second one, do we have to accept the charge-off report or is that
yes,
information?
Sir.
That,
yes,
that does require a vote?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Is there a motion to accept the charge-off report from the 2002 tax year?
So moved.
Thank you, Linda.
Second.
Bill?
I would say to add on to that, I think my department's done an outstanding job. We've had about a 15% budget cut in my department since I've taken over, and our collections have improved every month. So I think our department has done a great job, and I applaud them for that.
I agree.
I think they have to.
Thank you,
Gerald and Jeremy. Y'all have done a great job.
Gerald, let me call for the question on this, unless you have something else to say about 2002. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Now continue.
Our third order of business is the settlement of the current year taxes for tax year 2011. Each of you has a handout, and it's just lots and lots of numbers. I've asked Jeremy Akins, our assessment manager, to do a PowerPoint, just an overview of this so that we don't have to read the 75 numbers. If you're prepared for that, he'll do an overview of that.
That'd be great.
Sure. Jeremy, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Let's see if this is on. All right. Okay. As an overview, we're looking at the 2011 levy. The total levy was $79.75. Out of that, we collected $61,515,939.22. So we've got $1,765,140.53 uncollected. The important number for me is that that's a 97.21% collections rate. Now, if we look at the past 7 years, just to see how we're doing, you notice there's a break right here between tax years 2009 and 10. Previously, you're at 96% typically. Here's a year at 95. And I just want to make the note, that's when Gerald took over, and he's been very effective in his leadership. We are maintaining a 97% plus collections rate. If we break that down into the real and the non-RMV and personal property, we're doing better than last year, consistently better every year at 98.11%. And if we look at it over time, you can see that whereas in the 11 levy you're at 98%, by the time we get down to 2004, 99.91%. We're pretty much collecting everything in the real and the non-registered motor vehicle. Now with the registered motor vehicles, that's 87.14%. As compared to past years, that's pretty typical. And that always appears to be a low number. The reality is, if you look at it over time, the very next year it picks up to 98% and proceeds towards 99%. So we actually do collect most of that. The reason it's so low in the first year is that that is on a rotating basis throughout the year. So when we take our annual snapshot, there are bills that have been generated that have not yet come due. And so those are always unpaid. If you figure that you have a couple of months of unpaid, whenever the snapshot is taken, 87 is a good rate. Just a summary of the collections activities. The garnishments are up from 7,241 to 12,869. Debt set-off monies have increased. We're doing more rent attachments. That's where we go out and have the tenants pay their rents to satisfy the indebtedness of the landlord. Foreclosures are down, and this is a good sign. If you could see 2009, it was actually over 200 foreclosures. On the front end, there was a lot of clearing out because there have been several years of no foreclosure action. At this point, we're getting down to just a handful, and that's what we want to see. Obviously, no one wants to foreclose, so we like we've got that backlog taken care of. So the current year levy collected has increased every year from 9 to 10 and 10 to 11, so we are bringing in more money. And if you look at the back years, for each tax year, not the current year levy, but the back years we're collecting, has been falling off. So in 2009, we had $1.8 million outstanding. It's down to $1.7 in 10, and this year it's down to $1.5. So we're getting those back years in half. I thank you for your time.
Thank you. Thank you, Jeremy. Any questions for Jeremy? Both good work.
Yep.
Thank you.
Good care.
Next item on the agenda is the local emergency ordinance update. Here from Craig and Klein. Who's going first?
I'll go first. I put this on the, I asked it to be put on the agenda at our last meeting, and I think it'd be helpful to give the board and the public an idea.
Do you want to come up here?
Of why. Sure.
Let them see your face while you're talking.
Welcome.
Oh, thank you. In December 2008, at Mr. David Smith's request, I had repaired a local emergency management ordinance, because the law at that time and the law today says that if you don't delegate someone, if this board doesn't give that responsibility to someone, then that someone is the board chair. And in his absence, it's the vice chair. And during times of emergency, it's good to have a radio like the sheriff has and the fire marshal has, because I don't know if y'all remember, but when we had that little earthquake last year, everybody's cell phone quit working because everybody and his brother tried to call somebody on their cell phone, so it shut it down. So that reason and the fact that the sheriff and I were talking about the supplying deputies to the Democratic National Convention in Charlotte, and I was working on an inter-local agreement with the Charlotte Mecklenburg PD to send 30 of our deputies down to Charlotte for the Democratic Convention. And it was either during a discussion with the sheriff or with the police attorney down there that the question came up, well, if all our deputies are down there, what are we going to do if we have an emergency up here? And so, I asked the question, did we ever pass that emergency declaration ordinance? And we never did. In the meantime, Governor Perdue in 2010 declared the state of emergency throughout the state when we had a big ice storm. And then the town of King decided they were going to declare a state of emergency and forbid the sale or possession of firearms and ammunition during that state of emergency. And in 2010, in reaction to that declaration and the governor's declaration, Mr. Bateman and two other gentlemen filed a lawsuit in federal court. So it worked its way through the courts. In May of 2011, the General Assembly took up legislation to rewrite and reorganize the emergency management ordinances, which were spread out throughout the statutes. And so that died in committee, or didn't get out of committee, in May of 2011. It did come out of committee in May of this year, and that law was passed, signed by the governor, and it becomes effective October 1st. All that law does is recodify things, and it takes out of the definition of a deadly weapon lawfully possessed firearms and ammunition. And they did that in response to this lawsuit that was filed against the governor. In March 29th of this year, Judge Howard, federal judge, Eastern District of North Carolina, said that what the governor did was unconstitutional. Can't be done. So that happened March 29th. Our legislature is considering rewriting the law, and they did rewrite the law. And it all came together in June when I was looking at the sheriff's contract to send people down to Charlotte. And that's how the ordinance got before you. But at the end of the day, if you do nothing, the chairman of the board is still the person that declares an emergency in this county. And it's in his absence, the vice chair does. And it just seems to me that it'd be wise to have somebody with a workable radio that can make that declaration. Well, that's entirely up to the board. But in any event, it's unconstitutional to take somebody's lawfully possessed firearms from them. Anybody's got a concealed carry permit can still carry it. They can still carry their gun. They can still carry their ammunition, even in a state of emergency.
Those are the time you need a gun.
That's correct. More than ever.
That's right, more than ever. That's
and the fact that they took it out and of the definition of a deadly weapon, the legislature agrees, the federal court said amen, and if you want to leave the, if you want to leave it like it is, that's fine, but I thought it'd be a good opportunity to take that up again. So it's all my fault. I brought it up in my discussions with the sheriff. It just seemed to me like now's the time to bring it up.
What was the difference between what was in our packet
last time
versus King's, the King's original?
I've got the King. The problem. Well,
I have it too. But what's the difference between the two?
King doesn't have an ordinance. They just passed a resolution, and the federal court said sorry. They don't have an ordinance you can attack. They just declared it. At least we have the state statute that says our chairman gets to declare it. But the cities have to pass an ordinance. Burlington has an ordinance where they declare. Of course, their ordinance hasn't been rewritten since 1986.
That's right.
So they're going to have to change theirs. There's
compliance as well.
Yeah. But with all the technology we have today and everybody relying on cell phones and Twitter, That's the first thing that goes in an emergency, and that's why we have this 800 megahertz so people can talk to each other. We spent a lot of money setting it up, so I just feel like it's a good time to use it. It was not my intention to take anybody's weapon away from them, especially mine, because I got a concealed carry too. That's my rendition of the law.
Thank you, Klein.
Well, no, if you don't mind, I'd like to ask a couple questions. Number one, I didn't like the way, and neither did Bill, obviously, I don't like the way it was put in our consent agenda. Would that something that maybe not serious in some people's eyes, but would that not require a public hearing?
Does not require public hearing. However, one of the things that we need to do as staff, and Clyde and I talked about this, is anything that comes up like this, we need to do a better job about explaining what it is and why it's being requested. And instead of just basically putting in a sheet in your agenda packets under
it
consent.
It needs to be on the agenda.
And we need to make sure we go through that. And again, this has been a good learning experience for us as well, is that we're going to do a much better job of that in the future.
Was the ordinance that was in our packet... Excuse me.
Go ahead. I don't want you to hear this.
Was the ordinance that was in our packet... Did it coincide parallel with new law?
New law doesn't come effective until October 1st. So that's why the ordinance cited the old law.
But did it parallel what the Institute of Government put out?
Well, the,
as far as what that could say.
Right. The old law was just recodified in the new law. It's the same. It's the same things in the old law that's in the new law, just under a new number. And they did away with section 14288.12 that talked about deadly weapons. They changed that definition of a deadly weapon so that it does not include lawfully possessed handguns and ammunition.
What was the constant reference to gasoline? Can you explain that?
Other than the fact that in times of emergency, people hoard gasoline.
I can tell you what happens in the time of situation. I was in the riots in 1968, and what they do is they take gasoline and put it in a Coca-Cola bottle with a rag in it and set it on fire and throw it against your car, and they're very effective.
Well, I understand that, but
very effective.
Was it? Well, I'm not trying to. You know, I just didn't like the way this whole thing came down, and I don't believe the ordinance that was in our packet paralleled the new law at all. I was told that it was. I was told you said somebody else that it didn't. And it was just that kind of back and forth. And I mean, I've heard back and forth tonight. That I heard Dave Leonard was the one that requested it, and his name didn't come out tonight. So, and if you leave it up to the county manager to do it, I mean, the county board of commissioners, I mean, under what parameters would be set forth as far as what you could do under that state? I mean, if you didn't have anything, I mean,
Essentially the same thing that's in the ordinance that was before you last month, or last meeting, is what the county board chair could do. The only difference is he can't declare lawfully owned firearms and ammunition as a deadly weapon. He can do everything else. He or she, whoever the chair may be at the time.
Tim Brick can probably tell us what would be done during that time.
Well, certainly. I think state law already covers a lot of this. And our position, sheriff's office, certainly is not to restrict anybody's constitutional rights to firearms or anything else. I think a lot of it gives, my understanding is that the ordinance gives the authority if somebody's doing it with a nefarious intent. Like you said, somebody's making Molotov cocktails with gasoline or something, it gives you an ordinance to enforce. But like I said, most of this is already covered under state statute, state declaration of emergency.
So what we're trying to do is just clarify who has the authority to enact the.
That's correct.
The default act.
It'd be my suggestion would be someone with one of those 800 megahertz radios that knows.
Well, I mean, the sheriff is totally responsible for
whoever.
Safety in the county.
Yeah, they're going to do what they have to do to control
right.
The situation. no matter what the law is, they're going to do what has to be done. Right.
And the elected sheriff has a lot of authority on the emergency anyways for us.
And that's who I would
protecting the emergency citizens.
Well, Dave Leonard went about 3 years ago, wasn't it, Dave?
Yes, ma'am.
And we had a terrible storm coming through or something, and Dave sent me papers because I was the chair. And he said, Linda, do you know that you have to declare a state of emergency? I said, no, I didn't know that. And so he sent me all these papers, you know, and I said, well, do you want me to declare one right now? He said, no, not right now.
Hang on.
So, you know, Dave is the one that sent me the stuff. So, you know, I'm just thinking maybe Dave is the one that's, you know, gets this started because he does know where
and the sheriff would be the one enforcing the
exactly.
Parts. We will work closely with all emergency association agencies throughout the county. Every agency will have some input into what needs to be done as far as what areas and what type of event that we may have. And of course, work closely with whoever's has the ability to declare that emergency, whether it be the chair, the vice chair, or anyone else that the board names.
Stayed up like that night, too.
Yes, ma'am. Sure did.
In case you had to.
Yes, I had to do it, yeah.
Let me add, when I was reading the Modernization Act, the Emergency Act, the way I read it is only the governor or the legislature could actually enact a state of emergency, and that from the county local levels, it was a coordination issue that was handled through the chair. That's the way I read it. And when King, for example, they didn't actually, as I understand it, declare an emergency. They reacted to the emergency that the governor declared, and then they enacted the prohibitions to guns that the governor had placed as part of the law. And that's what came up against that to make taking the weapons illegal. It's true that the law allows things I don't agree with, calling gasoline, for example, I don't think that's right, but it is in the law to allow for that.
Well, I'm going to make a motion that we table it.
Motion on the floor to table the discussion of the ordinance.
Well, yeah, I'm going to second that. I'm going to say one more thing. What got me the other night was we're sitting in here, and I knew about King, but I didn't know about the name King. Go back and watch the DVD. I'm searching for the name King, okay? And the name Maiden came out. I don't know why Maiden. And then somebody took a member of the audience to tell us it was King. And it would appear to me that if we knew what was going on with such a legal process, that name would have come out for county management rather than a member of the audience. That's what bothers me. We have people that are paid hundreds of thousands of dollars in offices with combined staff making $250,000 or better, and I can't get a comment. I mean, I was searching for it. I kept saying there's a town in the mountains that there was a major controversy, and it had to come from a member of the audience rather than for management. That's what bothers me a whole lot. You know, we're lay leaders, and y'all are professional managers and professional departments, high paid, well paid. To some people, in excess, some people's minds. But to have to take a member of the audience to tell us what it was, where the controversy was, and as a result, find out about Stokes County and King and Chapel Hill's review of the law before we are even told it by county management. That's what bothers me the most. And I just hope next time we have something that we've researched it and that we know all the ins and outs and don't just lack in a lackadaisical way and stick something on the consent agenda, whether it needs to be there or not.
What does tabling it mean? I mean, what?
Nothing's done. It's just.
It disappears after.
Unlikely to reappear.
It means that Chairman Manning will declare a state of an emergency.
That's
basically what it means.
That's right. Maybe we need to readdress this.
We have a motion from Commissioner Vice Chair Lashley and a second by Commissioner Sutton to table the ordinance under discussion All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you.
There you go. You're welcome.
Okay, we do have one agenda item that was pulled from consent. Has to do with the landfill franchise to Coble Sandrock. Eddie, you pulled this from consent. You want to lead this discussion?
I will. I just had one question on this item here, and that was the amount of liability carried by the company. And I was hoping maybe Clyde could, I talked to him today a little bit, could bring, clarify this for some folks that asked me about it. And I said, well, I'll check. And I've checked, and I'm going to let him explain what he explained to me today.
Mr. Coble is required to have insurance, and he does have a multi-million-dollar policy.
Well, in the county form, it said he had $500,000.
Well, that's for the county.
But that's just to the county.
Right.
Okay.
But he has a much larger policy, and it's a well-run operation. I've been out there and looked at it, and Greg Thomas has also looked at it. It's a revenue stream for the county because he pays us.
Oh, I agree with her.
Based on the amount of construction debris that's in that landfill.
In the good days, I used to frequent him often.
We hope it'll return. Yeah,
that was the only question. So it basically, he does have more than just the 500. Yes, liability coverage that was stated in this.
His attorney and I have gone through this. She does this kind of work all over the Southeast, and state's satisfied, and I'm satisfied.
And another positive, by having a separate C&D landfill, it doesn't fill up our landfill. So
they run
a good
operation. They really
extends the life of it. Yeah. So Coble's does a wonderful job on that.
Okay.
We did pull this off consent, therefore it does need a motion for approval.
Motion.
Eddie making the motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Bill. Any other discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. County manager reports.
In front of you, we have one additional resolution. This is for the $40 million bonds that we approved to do at our last meeting. It is a resolution providing for the issuance of the GO refunding bonds. This is part of the additional steps. We do have to go through. We got this on Thursday afternoon. The reason why it was not in your agenda packet. But again, we did pass the amount not to exceed $40 million on July 16th, and this is the next step in the resolution process.
Any questions for Mr. Honeycutt on that resolution? Motion for approval?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you, Bill. Eddie, any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, Greg. What else?
A couple of dates. Please to place on your calendar. One is August 23rd. That's the City County Association Dinner, which will be at Lake McIntosh at 6 p.m. hosted by the City of Burlington. And also September 12th, if you remember, we had a economic summit that was kind of led by the Chamber and the City of Burlington. We will have a follow-up to that to kind of go over what we went through with far as our visits to the other communities and some additional information talking about the sales tax referendum and how we can use that for economic development. But that has been scheduled for September 12th. But right now, I believe it's at the Cronodal Senior Center in Burlington from 8 to 11 a.m. And that's all I have.
Thank you, Craig. This time, we'll have any additional commissioner comments. Are there any?
I want to tell you what we did at the Piedmont Pride Regional Council this past Wednesday. When the executive board met, we did approve to build a building. It will be like a lease purchase for 15 years, and it's going to cost, I'm thinking it's $25 million is what it's going to cost. So, that was, of course, it's still got to come before the board, the big board, the full board, which is going to be the 14th this month, I think it's the 14th, so, which will be in Kernersville again, so, which is where we meet now. It's called Paul Senior Gardens, but we did pass that this past week. Yeah.
Anything else?
Yep.
And also, with respect to that, I believe on the 20th at our next meeting, they will be coming, the COG will be coming here because we have to pass a resolution in support of that debt as
exactly.
well. So,
exactly.
So they will be coming at our next meeting.
Will it take a contribution from us at all?
No additional contribution.
Any other comments?
I just noticed a thing on the news before it came today. It was interesting that the city of Greensboro, Winston, and High Point had gone together, and now they're put together before one will commit to any incentives. The other councils have to agree on kind of what I understood, that they're trying to be more collaborative in their municipalities, and maybe we can think of that as we look forward to doing something in the economic development program with
well,
that
what,
too.
What it was, and I brought the article tonight.
Oh, did you bring it?
Yeah,
okay.
There was an article and editorial against the communities bidding against each other.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And they're trying to stop that.
I think that's good. I mean, we're all in this thing together, really.
Well, one other thing too about the Council on Government, Guilford County did not come in this year to start with, and they just now have come back into the COG. So that is a big, the reason they didn't come in was they wanted us to allow them to not pay as much because they were the biggest municipality. They didn't want to pay what the 22 cents or whatever I think it was.
That's right.
And they wanted us to drop that on them. And we voted not to drop anybody's, you know, as far as that goes. So they dropped out for about a year now. They have not been in the COG, but they, Carolyn Coleman was there on Wednesday. And so they are back in the COG again. So they're paying their dues. So just wanted
their
to let you know
their fair share, right?
Yeah, they're paying their fair share.
Well, if it was up to me, I'd vote to drop out of it. I see no gain whatsoever except for cost
well,
being in that COG.
But see, that's like Miss Berry. She's the one that handles all of the money for the elderly, and that goes through the COG. The COG gets that money
the
first,
grant money.
And she disperses it based on your population as far as that goes. So,
well,
and
geez,
I see a lot of.
We need to get them to do more for us, though.
Well,
that's the problem. I mean. Yeah. You know, the COG,
I see no gain whatsoever for the Alamance County.
You know, honestly, if it weren't for the COG, I don't think Random and Dam would have ever been built, the lake and all that, as far as that. We need to get more.
Well, and we use some of those. We do use those people. You know, the municipalities use it. All the municipalities, we've used them in Hall River. You know, they go out and to see if you can extend your lines and all that stuff. They do, you know, they do have, I think it's very important to have the COG. Myself. Anyway, and now it's 12 counties instead of 5.
Thank you, Linda.
Mr. Chairman, if I could say one other thing, I forgot to mention on my update. Again, I want to thank Gerald. Where's Gerald and his staff? It's been a pleasure to work with them and the work that they have done and the commitment that they have. To make sure that we're generating every dime we can for Alamance County, and I just wanted to publicly say that. So thank y'all.
Very good. Couple things. Speaking of good news, I don't think we announced last time the preservation award.
We did not.
That was awarded for the efforts of the county courthouse. Preservation North Carolina announced that Alamance County has been named a recipient of the Gertrude Caraway Award of Merit for the preservation of the Alamance County Historic Courthouse. And it's real nice. And Karen, I thought you covered it great in your paper. So it's a good honor and congratulations to everybody that worked on that project. And I don't see any of the facilities folks here, do I?
Yeah.
But that was a very, very nice award. And then also our own Barry Bass was awarded a, I'm not sure what it is, but they got an award for the best practice in an outbreak award for the way they handled the pertussis outbreak here in Alamance County. They're recognized at the 2012 North Carolina Communicable Disease Conference that was held in June. So congratulations to Barry. And I just want to add a couple of comments about some of these dates. Craig mentioned the city-county meeting. We actually are on that meeting, right? We're going to discuss to the other municipal governments the process of this sales tax and everything we talked about tonight and answer any questions. So I appreciate Craig getting us in there to do that. So certainly if all of us can go, that'd be great. If you can't, certainly other things do come up. But that would be a good time to answer any questions and hopefully get the education process going of just explaining what we did and why we did it. And that will be at the City County Association meeting. Craig also mentioned the City Economic Summit that Ronnie Wall really started last year. Many of us were in attendance for that. Last year it was held at the Gathering Place out at Twin Lakes, and as you said, so far it's going to be at the Knodel Center.
Yes, sir.
That was a good dialogue, a good question and answer session, and again, it would give us the opportunity to discuss a little bit about what we're looking for on the economic development side. I do want to mention the, and I've got mixed emotions about this because of what happened last year, but the Triad Business Journal is once again hosting their state of Alamance County. I've got mixed emotions about it because we really didn't get an invitation other than what was in the paper, to the best of my knowledge, maybe an email, and yet our board was criticized for, you know, not being there in bigger numbers. And frankly, the only reason I really went was not representing the county, but I was representing where I work. And it was like, okay, let's lead them to the fire and then pick on them when they don't show up. And it is a profit-making ordeal for the paper. And so, like I said, I've got mixed thoughts about it, and I've talked to the publisher about it. But it is going to be here, and it is going to be discussed. It was last August at that meeting that Community College president was there and stood up and said some things about his plan that he had apparently collaborated with the MC of the day, the guy that was formerly with the paper. So I say that because almost defensively we need to consider going. It is August 24th, it's at Alamance Country Club, and of course his paper says Alamance County Club, but I guess we can't hold him after that. But I would encourage, if Craig, if it's all right with you, if we can let you know who wants to go to this and you can sign us up.
Yes, sir.
For that. And then the other one is the annual Chamber Economic Summit, which is held in October. And this is one that the Chamber gets folks involved to come and lead and really talk about the regional economy. This particular time, I think Dave King, president and CEO of LabCorp, is scheduled to speak. And they'll have several other people, economist type, on that program. That's October the 16th. So again,
what's the time on that?
It is, that one is
4
to 6:30, and that one's held on the campus of Elon in the business school there. And maybe Craig, if you and Tori could get together and just send out all of these
An
email form with dates,
yes,
and let all of us respond back to you on each of those.
Yes, sir.
Then we'll go from there. But yeah, thanks, Bill. It's 4 to 6:30. The one that's at Alamance Country Club is a breakfast on Friday, August 24th, from 7:30 to 9:30. 7:30 to 9:30 on August 24th. And with that, I will ask if there's any other business to come before the board. If not, we stand adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.